Lord, here we go again. You guys get absolutely hammered this time of year with Wells Fest, Wells Fest, Wells Fest, but it takes that kind of organization to pull this thing off. My name is Elaine Talbot. I am the chair of the silent auction for Wells Fest. And those of you who've been around a while know my standard pitch, so it's not going to deviate a whole long. In fact, we could probably have a call and response by this time. But the Wells Fest silent auction is new merchandise and gift certificates that are auctioned off for a bargain price or better. Every dime that we get, less the rental on the tent, goes to the beneficiary. We are a very skinny organization as far as our expenses go. But we have to rely not only on the merchants in the community and on the Wells Fest committee, but I'm deputizing all of you as part of the committee. If you go out and you do business with somebody on a regular basis, that's a prime target for somebody that could be a donor to Wells Fest. No one is safe from me. My nail tech donates, my hairdresser donates, my dentist donates a cleaning and a comprehensive exam. So, you know, I just absolutely don't have any shame in my game. Another good thing that I've learned through bitter experience is that, I don't know about you, but I have friends that give me things, or family in particular, give me things from time to time as gifts that, you know, they're lovely. There's not a thing in the world wrong with them. They're just not anything that I'll ever use. So I used to put them on a shelf in the closet, which was my re-gifting shelf. And I would wrap them up and give them to somebody else. And oftentimes, the recipient was really happy to get that particular thing. Until the time that I gave the thing back to the person that gave it to me in the first place. And she called me on it. She said, "Didn't I give this to you 2 years ago?" Busted. So I decided from then on that those things are now silent auction donations. So anytime that my sister-in-law gets my name for Christmas, I know that I'm going to have a silent auction donation. You know, that's just baked in. So, you know, it's never too early to start bringing those things to me or to one of the other silent auction committee members. The other members are Lewin Buchanan, Lily Floyd, Jan Watson. She's not going to be here for Wells Fest, but she'll be happy to pass it along. So if you see any of those folks or me, or you can bring them to the church, much to their chagrin, they'll stash them. Jane, don't give me that look. So that's, you know, that's what I'm all about. That's my mission for the next 3 weeks. And I would appreciate anything you can do. And the choir will now call us to worship.
Thank you.
please stand as we share the opening sentences. We gather in the presence of God, who knows us when we wake up and when we go to sleep and all the moments in between.
We gather in the house of God, who has created a family for us, here as well as in Madrid, Tlaloc, and in Baton Rouge.
Please share the prayer.
And gracious God, we gather to be the people of God, who appeals to us to follow in love, in faith, in service. Amen.
Please turn in your hymnal to page 526. We will sing all verses of What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Turn to page 881 if you don't have this memorized by now. If you choose to affirm your faith with us, join us as we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. I do things a little different this morning. I'll tell you more about that when we get to the time for the message. But I invite you right now, if you would, to turn and look at the back of your order of service. The scripture reading from this morning from the text of the message that I'd like to share with you. And the title of the message is Trying to Wrap My Head Around That. Comes from Psalm. It's the Psalm of David. God, investigate my life. Get all the facts firsthand. I'm an open book to you, even from a distance. You know what I'm thinking. You know when I leave, you know when I get back. I'm never out of your sight. You know everything I'm going to say before I start the first sentence. I look behind me and you're there. Then you're up ahead and you're there too. Your reassuring presence coming and going. This is too much, too wonderful. I can't take it all in. I can't wrap my head around that. When I was in a youth ministry, one of the things that we did toward the end of camp, actually the last night of camp, we all had communion. And we had set the chairs up in this big circle. And we put the elements on a table in the center of the circle. And I got a large string of yarn. Everybody know what yarn is, right? You know, cats play with yarn, all right? And what we would do is I would start the yarn with one person. They would hold one end of the yarn, and then they would hold the bundle of yarn. And what they would do is they would then take the bundle of yarn to someone else seated in the circle that had been at camp all week. And when they took that bundle of yarn to them, they held on to one end, and they shared with that person how they affirmed them in life, how they made a difference for them. Maybe it was just that week at camp, or maybe it's something that had happened months and months or years ago. But they went there, and they handed that. And this went on throughout all things, and you couldn't get it twice. So if you're one of these kids that just always thought, well, I'm going to go give it to so-and-so. And it was the way kids and adults had to interact and figure out positive, affirming things to say to one another. One of the guys that was a staple at the camps that I did as a youth minister was a guy named Billy Crockett. He's a songwriter. If you get a chance, check out Blue Rock Artist Ranch right outside of Austin, Texas. It's on Facebook and it's also on the web. But the next year, right before we did this particular exercise, Billy said, I got a song I want to play that you guys inspired me to write, and it's called Lines. And so this morning, I want you to think about communion. It's first Sunday here. We take it. As many of you know, I've gone back to seminary, and I'm actually learning some things. It's amazing what you can do. You know, a mind is a terrible thing to waste, right? I explained to our kids on Wednesday night what the United Negro College Fund, and you know, that slogan that they had. But it is. We should always be learning. We should always be challenging ourselves to learn more. And one of the things that I've learned in this early Methodism class is that John Wesley and I are a lot alike, very, very much alike. Because John Wesley has this unbelievable desire to be good and to be a good vessel for God, to be holy. But he has this problem. He's a human being, and he's a sinner. And he wants this desire to be captivated by his life. He wants to please God constantly and do the things that God's called him to do. And I want to do that too, but I'm really not very good at it. I try, and I have good moments, you know. But for the most part, and this is not NC-17, so I can't say what I'd really want to say, but a lot of times I just stink at it. But what happens with communion is that we say to ourselves, we are taking the body of Christ. We are taking the blood of Christ. And that is becoming incarnate in us. I'll share with you these lyrics from the song. And I want you to think this morning about somebody here that knows you. They know when you get up. They know when you go to sleep. They know what you do. And I'm not necessarily talking about your spouse, but someone that knows you. What connection do you have with them? And what has this church done to instill that connection or to make it deeper? A spider spins the line from leaf to ladder. A trellis spans the canyon of Kathmandu. A transatlantic cable carries transatlantic chatter, and there are lines that run from me to you. Lines, a circumstantial glance from a passing stranger, both exchanging sadness of the soul. Time will take the travelers so they may not remember, but there are lines that hold them even so. Lines, lines that run from vine to branches, lines that carry love's advances. For those who find their place in time, there are lines. How the strong and mighty take their places, following the politics of war. Eliminate the enemy and never see their faces, there are lines that maybe we ignore. Lines, now and then I hear my grandma's laughter from that great cloud of witnesses above. And every generation from Abraham thereafter makes the lines that lead us back to love. For those who find their place in time, and for those who long to know that they belong, and for those who pray, and for those who up and walk away, there are lines. What do you wish God did not know about you? David says he knows your thoughts even before you think them. That he knew each of us before we ever burst forth from the water in the womb. To be known by the most powerful God in the universe, and yet loved. You think about the people that know you the best. If any of y'all talk to Leanne after this, I'm going to get really mad at you. But she can just about finish my sentence before I do it myself. I was telling, we were laughing sitting around the pool yesterday, and Jason Bobbs, for many of you, don't come to 11th service. Jason sits where Uncle Charlie sits with his daughter, Abby. And you can pray for them because his stepdaughter tried to commit suicide Friday night. But he's doing well and is out of Brentwood. But Jason says, you know, when you preach, I don't really have to look at you. I said, really? He says, no. He said, I can listen to you and just watch your wife and tell what I need to listen to and what I don't. He said, and when she gives you these looks, those could kill. And I said, they have many times over, you know. To be known. You go back and you read the King James Version, and it gives you a little more dramatic dialogue. But the end of this chapter in 139, it says, wherever I go, whether I go to the highest point of heaven in the world, or the lowest point of hell in the world, or they use Sheol in the King James, I am never alone, for you are with me. Never alone. At the end of the session at camp, you look up, and you've got this spider web of yarn that stretches between 120 to 150 kids sitting in this large room. Everyone is connected. When you come to the table today, I want you to find someone in this place, and I want you to invite them to the table. We'll have it set up a little different, and I'll explain that later. But bring someone. It doesn't have to be just one person. You could bring five people with you. It doesn't matter. But when you bring them to the table, you're bringing people to the most holy thing that you can share. The body of Christ and the blood of Christ by which you are known. Let's pray together. God, you know us when we rise up. You know us when we go to bed. You know us when we think stupid things about the car in front of us because they can't drive like we think they should. You know the snide remarks that we say about people, and we try to make it okay by blessing their heart. You know our thoughts before we think them. And yet in the freedom in which you've created us, you allow us to make fools of ourselves from time to time. And other times you allow us to be somewhat saintly. So God, as we seek to know you better, help us understand how you know us. And how that you love us in spite of our frailties, in spite of our weaknesses. We are known and loved, really, really loved by you. In our own feeble way this morning, we say thank you. We also acknowledge the words that your Son taught us to pray as we pray together. Our Father, with you. Thanks, y'all.
Okay, please stand as we sing the first three verses of number 512, Stand By Me. Remain standing and turn to page 854. We're going to responsively read Psalm 139, verses 1 through 6. O Lord, you have searched me and known me.
You know that.
You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Even before the word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it altogether.
You pursue me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it.
Time now to take a look at one another and to say hello. Peace. God bless you. Glad you're here. Okay, let's get together. Let's get together. Let's get together. Okay, let's try it. Somebody sing it with me. Good morning to you. Good morning to you. Good morning, good morning, good morning to you. Cha-cha-cha. That's a song we sing every Tuesday morning when our community gathers. And it's the song of the great commandment. God, good morning to you. Others, good morning to you. And self, good morning to you too. And good morning to each of you. Blessings and peace. And thank you so very much for being present with us. Yesterday, the funeral for Wesley's wife's mom, our security guard and member of our congregation, was held at their church, and words cannot express our appreciation for the hospitality shown to us during our time of loss of our mom. May you continue to be blessed. A little love note from Wesley and from his wife, Carolyn. It was a long, strong, good celebration of a life well lived. And that's one of the things all of us can hope for when our time comes. And we're on the other side, that some people can rejoice in how we lived. That's a good word. So with that in mind, thank you. We rejoice in your presence today. I think most of us are family, but the service of Holy Communion is open to all. None are denied. You are warmly invited. You know why? It's the table of Christ and not ours. And he said, whosoever will. And so feel free to come if you are moved to do that. Tracy and Jeff, I talked to her last night. I said, Lord, you sound tired. And she said, yeah, we really worked hard. We did not have many. We had three from the church to go down. It's a tough weekend. We understand that. But they got a lot accomplished. And she said, a particular thanks to those of you who sent along a little love offering. She said, we feel a little strange because we're not poor people. And I said, we understood that from the beginning. What it is the poor can get help, and the rich don't need help, and some of those people in the middle sort of get caught up in it. So anyway, thank you very, very much from the bottom of our hearts. Remember to sign up for Wells Fest. Somebody said the other day, we understand that your church is famous. And I said, in what sense? Famous for not signing up quickly. And so maybe Ashley will talk about that in a minute. We'll see. Tuesday morning neighborhood ministries, needs canned foods, etc. You've been great about that, and thank you. We're trying to work out the bread situation, and we've had several suggestions. One of them is bring a loaf of bread, but the truth is that we have more than 100 clients weekly, and it's a little hard to coordinate that. So I don't know how many bread prayers you can pray, but if you will, pray one that opens the door for the bread. Leonard, for many years, Leonard Blanton, was able to get bread and bring it, and the rules have changed, and that changes that too. Talking about golfers, you want to say anything about that, John?
For those of you hackers and for those of you that just have golf clubs that haven't come out of your closet for 30 years, get them out. Come out and play golf on September the 15th, starting at 1 o'clock. We have a shotgun start at Live Oaks, which is right off Highway 49 in between Clinton and Pocahontas. It's a four-person team scramble. It's a shotgun start. That means everybody will go off at the same time on different tees. Last year was the first year we had it. We had five teams play, and yet we still raised over $2,000 for our beneficiary. We're trying to at least double that many teams this year. So if you know somebody that plays, maybe you don't play that much. This is a fun tournament, okay? You know, the prizes are not worth winning, okay? They're good prizes. You may want to give them to Elaine for Christmas.
Thank you, sir. With that in mind, remember at Six Pack Sundays, bring in name brand drinks and water. Quick story here. We had a guy in the neighborhood, Ivory Lee was his name, and had mental problems. Sometimes he thought it was Jesus. Sometimes he thought it was Mohammed, and so forth. But one day he scared Luella Moore, who was at that time our secretary and assistant, half to death. And I got on him. I said, don't you ever come by again here telling Luella that you're the devil. And I said, because I'm going to send you to the place where the devil is. And, you know, I really kind of lost it. And in a few minutes, there was a knock on the door, and here came Ivory Lee with a six-pack of Bud for me. He said, I know you were mad. He said, I need to make this thing up. And I said, well, Ivory Lee, I appreciate that, but I don't drink. He said, you don't drink Bud? And I said, no. He said, just a minute. So he came back with a six-pack of Pepsi. And... bring name brands if you possibly will. The altar flowers placed today by Lacey Thomas and Carolyn Thomas in memory of Rita and Henry Thomas's anniversary. May the Lord bless them. Other announcements? Yes, my dear.
Thank you. So the great news is that no matter, unless you want to work the morning shift of the plant sale, that's the only volunteer opportunity that's full. Only about 7% of our slots have been filled. So anything you want to work is open. Yay.
Hallelujah. Yeah, and if you will, have somebody that you know and love sign up with you so it gets to. Yes, sir. Bob. Bob was there yesterday working.
And I'm going to say something about that. Okay. But Jane was gracious enough for the first time ever in the history of Wellsfest, we have a pet parade fly.
Amen. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
Pet parade fly. Thank Jane for that. On the back, I see we're looking at that. On the back, I put some of these out. So we have a pet parade. Does everybody know that?
Yes.
It's a dog parade.
And cats, okay.
As the cat lovers say. And we love cats, too. They just don't like to come. We don't bring them. Maybe they need to talk to their owners. But anyway, it starts at 9:30. We have three awards that the Mustard Seed is making for us, some bowls. They're really great. We have best dressed, most congenial, and cutest.
Okay.
So bring your... the water didn't rise from the river. It just fell on top of them, and it was nowhere to go. And everywhere you look, there's garbage, and it's incredibly drastic. And they do. We went down. We had a great team yesterday. But just remember, no, it doesn't matter what station in life you are. You need heaven. You need, if it's nothing more. But for me, it's mostly just going and making and doing the strain thing that we've been hurt here. Mm-hmm. You know, that, you know, I'm not a great carpenter or anything like that. I don't have talents in that one. But I can go and be present. So.
Thank you, Don. There are going to be teams going out again, and if any of you are interested, this was not a good weekend, and nobody needs to go. It's just if you feel moved in your heart to want to go, that would be very important. Any other announcements that need to be made now from anyone?
Yes, I would just like to invite everybody to Wednesday night. We have a bunch of different classes for a bunch of different people. There's Keith's class, the youth have a class, we have a discussion, an adult discussion. We're doing a wonderful series called Living the Questions to just talk about what Christianity means today. So please come out. You can come for dinner at 6:30. It's a very cheap price of $5, $20 per family, and we'd love to see you.
And kids.
And children. And children. Remember, we have a children's area as well. Okay, if there are no other announcements, what we're going to do today briefly is for our prayer requests. Make it a little quicker because we're running a little late. If you have a prayer request, just raise your hand and we'll deal with it. We'll try to speak quickly about what it is. Yes, Elizabeth.
I don't feel off my bike and I'm breaking off.
Oh, bless your heart. That's just what you need, huh? Okay, we will definitely do that. Yes, dear. Okay, we will certainly lift that up. Yes, dude.
My dad and a friend of ours passed away.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Did I see? Yes.
Morella Hennigan's cousin and a childhood friend of mine, Jane Hughes' husband, passed away.
Okay. Yes, Beth. Bill Gray's mom, yeah.
New grandson, Sam.
New grandson, Sam. Are we ready? Yes.
Yeah, BJ's got some issues that she's dealing with. She's going to have surgery next month.
Yeah. Nancy Alford, too, from our crew, has not been well. I have chemo again on Tuesday this week. They gave us Labor Day off. Any other requests? Noah, where? Okay, yes. Okay, thank you, sir. Yes, dear. Okay, are you ready? Let's pray together, please. Our Father, it's a real church thing to do, to pray. In fact, that's what we're about. That's that string, that line of connection between us and you. And we have named names, and we have talked about people and their circumstances and their conditions. And we know, God, that you care about them without our prayer. But we pray that our prayer will also add comfort and strength and help to them at the very point of their need. We lift our prayers to you sincerely and in the name of Jesus. Amen. Birthdays, anniversaries this particular week. Yes, Steve.
My parents' 60th anniversary. Huh.
You said so much. Your dad was dad sick. Is your dad sick right now? Okay. Yes, Ann. Okay. Yes, all the way in the back, young lady. Okay. Yes, Bill. Okay, John. All righty. Yes. All righty. Are we ready? Yes. Oh, Brother Don. Okay, John, do us. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. God bless you and keep you. Happy birthday to you.
like to receive tithes and offerings now, if you'd like to give them. And if you don't feel like giving them, don't do it. Because the scripture says, be a cheerful giver. And if you're not a cheerful giver, you would be an unhappy giver, and that wouldn't be good. If you're totally broke, you can take a dollar out, but please, no more. It's a little slow lately, okay? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thanks so much for this lovely, for this very supportive congregation. To think that we've been able to do things we never dreamed we could do, like give away $1 million to charities across the years of Wells Fest. Lord, keep us going, and help us to keep going by way of these very tithes and offerings. Thank you in Christ. Amen.
Growing up in the Baptist church, communion happened once a quarter in the morning service and maybe twice a year in the evening service. But it was always really cool because we never knew when it was going to happen. It just, you walk in, you'd see the bulletin. And you know, when I was in junior high and high school, I was like, oh, this is great. We don't have to listen to the preacher today. We get to take communion, you know. But when I would go with my friends who were Catholic, it was every time, but I couldn't go down front. And so finally I got to go to an Episcopal church that was, anybody could partake of communion. And it was then that I realized, and I was in seminary at the time, that the Baptist church and maybe some of the other Protestant denominations really got it wrong. Because the preachers seem to think it's all about them. They think it's all about the sermon. When in reality, worship, the sermon, and I'm saying it because I know it to be true, the sermon is not the most important thing that happens in the service. It's one of those things that prompts you, hopefully, to think. One of the first times I ever got criticized, which was about the third Sunday I was in Centerville, the guy said, why do we do communion every month? We don't do that much around here. I said, well, I just think it's really important that at least once a month we acknowledge the sacrifice that Christ made. Well, I think it's stupid. You know, and a lot of people do. But when you get to the point and you realize, especially in the Catholic service mass and also in the Episcopal church, the homily is not the most important thing. The most important thing is when you get down to communion. Now, a lot of people, when you have the loaf, when they come to take a little piece of bread from the loaf, they try to get the smallest piece because they just, and just barely touch the grape juice. When spring is just kind of moving into summer, how many of you folks out there, when you're at a swimming pool, you walk up to the pool and you just touch down to see how, raise your hand if you do that. The rest of y'all are lying. You know my philosophy on that is if you've got to test the water, you probably don't need to be getting in anyway. The first thing I do is I just run off the diving board and I go, and I'm in. I may be freezing, but I'm in, you know. When you take communion, get all you can get. Every now and then somebody will grab two breadcrumbs and they'll go, oh, I'm sorry. I'm going, no, get more if you want it. It's more of the body. Soak that bread in the juice, the blood of Christ. buddy of mine said he traveled the country singing about Jesus. And he said, people always ask him this question. What's at the bottom of life? When you get down to the bottom of life, what's there? And he goes through the whole song and he gets to the last couple lines of the song. He said, what, Lord? You said love is at the bottom of life? Well, Lord, ain't that just like you, putting love at the bottom of life? In a few moments, Elaine and I will be standing over here, and I'm going to ask Keith and Anthony if they would to stand right here. Go grab the hand of someone, a person. Maybe there's someone you've kind of held a grudge against, or maybe someone said something about you. Maybe you just need to go be with somebody. But when you come to the table, you lay all that at the altar. We're not going to do it like we usually do with gathering the hands and holding hands and praying this morning, but just come with someone that means something special to you or someone that you want to make reconciliation with. Or maybe someone that in this church has meant something to you that's drastically changed your life and made you better because of who they are. Pieces of life laid on the table. The cup poured out in love. The body broken, despised, mangled. It's powerful. If you think about it. Pray with me. Lord, none of us are really worthy to come to your table. But even as the woman came to you and said, the dogs get the crumbs from the table, you said, you know what? You don't get the crumbs anymore. You get the main course and all the fixings. And God, it cost you your son. Jesus, it cost your life. As we take the bread and as we dip it into the cup this morning, we do so praying for peace within ourselves and peace to all that we come in contact with. And we promise God to pray for peace, to ache for peace. And as we come this morning, we raise the cup skyward to heaven, and we remember the words that you told to the disciples, that you would not partake of that cup or the bread again until we're all gathered with you in glory. So here's to the day, God. Here's to the day. In the name of Christ, we ask you bless the cup. We ask that you bless the bread that may become part of us and us part of you. In your name.
What about what I need? What about what's best for me? What about how I feel? What about me? What about me? It's more than you. It is more than me. No matter what we are a family. Each dream is for all of us. This one can be real, and you can't stop us now because of how you feel. It's more than you, it is more than me. No matter what we are a family. We're not alone anymore, now there are others there. And that dream's big enough for all of us to share. So don't think you're going, you're not going anywhere. You're staying and taking your share. And if you get afraid again, I'll be there. 'Cause we are a family, like a giant tree, branching out toward the sky. We are a family. We are so much more than just you and I. We are a family, like a giant tree, growing stronger, growing wiser. And we are growing free.
513, Soldiers of Christ Arise. It's the tune of Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Please stand as we sing the first verse. Sit and just carry on conversations with people. Let's sing our benediction hymn. Thank you for being here.